My name is Dick Ault, and my family and I intend to live like primitive people.
This is Joe Pyne, and the action starts in just a moment. Recently, we had an Adam and Eve who intend to try living on a deserted island together. Now we have the patriarch of a contemporary Swiss family Robinson. Our guest is Dick Ault. Mr. Ault plans to leave for an uninhabited island in the Pacific. It is part of the Kingdom of Tonga. He is going with his wife and daughter. Mr. Ault has overcome his wife's objections. His daughter, however, has not told him what she thinks about living on lizards. She's, by the way, only 3 1/2. Think there'll be a little trouble there, Dick?
I don't think so, really. We've spent 5 years in the planning stages of this. The thing originally came up 5 years ago, and we started to think about it, and we are 100% prepared to go, or we wouldn't go.
Dick, you're a young man. How old are you?
I was 30 years old. I am 30 years old now.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now, of course, because your daughter is still relatively young, 3 1/2, there's no problem about school yet.
No.
You're not planning on doing this permanently.
Oh, no. We, 5 years ago, somehow come on a date or a time period of 1 year, mm-hmm. and we intend now to stick with this.
That's what I read about in the paper, that you and your wife had decided on 1 year.
Yes.
You have been a broadcaster.
I was in radio for about, off and on for 8 years.
Did being in radio have something to do with the decision to forsake society?
No, absolutely not.
Didn't make you antisocial?
No.
If it did, I can understand it, because it certainly has made me antisocial.
No, we're not forsaking society or trying to get away from it all permanently. We essentially do want to get away from it all for a year, just to experience what it'll be like to be away from civilization. This is the basis for going in the first place, is the experience in itself.
Is there something about civilization that you don't like? Are there many things about it you don't like?
No. I love people. I love, I love
democracy. You look like a gregarious type of guy. You're not the type of guy that would slink away and hide his light under a bushel. That's why it's difficult to understand this approach.
No, as I say...
You're too young to be disillusioned.
Thank you. One of the reasons that we are going, and that my wife and I decided a year ago that we definitely would go, was the fact that we wanted to get away from the headaches that we have today to see if modern civilized people can live happily when all signs of civilization have been erased. This is our objective.
Dick, are you and the wife planning on writing a book?
We have had an offer. People, have talked about writing a book because of the publicity and everything.
Right.
And
mm-hmm.
we, of course, are going to make notes and... of events that take place while we're down there. I imagine ultimately a book will come of it. I have no idea at this time.
It says on my notes here that you intend to live on iguanas, whatever fish you can catch, that you're terribly fond of seafood.
Well, I like fish, you know. We are going to live on iguana, fish, certain types of birds that abound in the islands. Also, there is a lot of wild fruit growing and taro roots and things of this nature that we'll be living off of. We are going to take a few seeds with us. This is something we've decided on in the last couple of months.
You will plant?
Oh, yes, indeed so.
And are you aware of what will grow there and what will not grow?
Yes, very much so.
You apparently have informed yourself about Tonga.
Oh, indeed so. We had left Ohio some 4 months ago and have been out in Honolulu, Hawaii since then.
Doing what?
4 months ago, we had an island in the Cook Island group in the South Pacific that we were originally going to.
Right.
We'd been given permission by the premier of the Cook Islands to occupy this particular island for a year. The island is named Suvorov.
Oh, yes, I know it.
This is where Robert Dean Frisbee lived for some time, and also Tom Neal, a New Zealander, lived down mm-hmm. there for 5 years by himself. So we were quite familiar with that island.
What changed that?
We'd received upon about a week's prior to departure for Samoa, where we was going to take a ship out to the island. We received a telegram from the High Commissioner in Wellington, New Zealand, the External Affairs Commissioner, I should say, stating that they had granted permission prior to the Premier granting us permission. They had granted permission for a team of pearl divers to occupy the island.
So. And did you feel that that would exclude you, or were they excluding you?
No, well, we felt that it definitely would exclude us now, because...
What I mean to say is, were they saying that you couldn't go, or just advising you that you wouldn't be the only ones on the island?
Well, The telegram didn't say one way or the other. It simply said that they had granted previous to our getting permission for a team of Pearl divers to go there. So we dropped it right there. Mm-hmm. As I mentioned, we want a completely uninhabited island. We want to be alone. We want to be isolated.
Dick, how are you supporting yourself in Hawaii, which seems to be pretty high these days?
It is indeed. During the 4 months we were there, we went through about $3,500.
Did you not work?
No, I didn't. We spent all of our time in research and everything else.
I'm surprised you didn't grab yourself a disc jockey job at one of the radio stations.
Well, I had plans to at one time. One of the big problems was the fact that we ran into, I think, about two or three other situations where we thought we had an island that was ideally situated and that had the fresh water and vegetation that we need.
Right.
But it seemed that something always happened to it. It was either a governmental problem, a privately owned problem, and that we couldn't get permission to go to the island.
This program is heard over a Hawaii radio station, and also, of course, our television program is heard over a Hawaiian television station, and I'm wondering if some of them listening in now think they might have missed a bet after hearing your fine voice and not hiring you while you were there. Did you run out of dough?
Yes, and this is why we returned to Los Angeles.
To do what?
Basically, to exploit some of the commercial possibilities that people prior to our going to Hawaii had talked about.
In other words, you're back now to see if you can get some of these people who initially offered sponsorship.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Have you been successful?
I think so. I contacted a number of people here in town. We had held a press conference in Los Angeles prior leaving to Hawaii, and of course I met a great deal of people then. One of the major networks now is talking about producing a documentary of the adventure, supplying camera and film for us to take along and this type of thing.
But not technical crew?
Again, they're talking about the possibility of sending a technical crew down with us.
Well, that would kind of take the edge off, would it not?
Well, this would be only for our arrival on the island. Then the crew and the ship would leave.
And then presumably come back on your departure.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
What about medical supplies?
We're taking complete medical supplies. For the last year, a very personal friend of mine, who's a doctor back in Ohio, has worked with us on this, and he's made us, put together for us, I should say, a number of books, which he has personally written himself after studying us and our health and everything else.
Plus, you will probably have a large copy of Grey's Anatomy, I would think. Have you thought about that book?
No, I don't, no.
That's a good one.
Oh.
Grey's Anatomy. Mm. Every doctor worth his salt has read it a couple of times. But I have to say the same thing to you that I said to these two young people. Well, as a matter of fact, he's about 10 years older than you are, but she's about 10 years younger, who are going to go and live like Adam and Eve on one of the uninhabited American Samoan islands. They're going to spend some time, and then they're going to construct a raft and drift back on the favoring seas to Pango Pango, from which they'll originally depart. They're going to wear fig leaves, by the way. They're taking no medical supplies, but the thing that I said to them is what I would say to you now. What would you do, for example, if your wife came down with appendicitis?
Well, now, this is something that we have thought of, Joe, and during the 3 months in Hawaii, I spent 2.5 months desperately searching for what they call a Mayday emergency transmitter. This was used extensively during the war. You may be familiar with it.
Mm-hmm.
Finally, I come
you
to
mean
find
the kind
out
you crank like a Mae West?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Finally, I come to find out that there's a new version of this. It's called the lifeboat transmitter. And after searching high and low to try and find one of these, I received a call from the Coast Guard one day, and they said, I have a present for you. And they gave us a brand new lifeboat transmitter.
Is it still the kind that you grip with your knees and turn a crank?
It is, basically. It has some improvements in that it has two separate frequencies.
But you don't have to rely on batteries.
Oh, no, no.
You generate your own.
Yes, mm-hmm.
Your
it
own
generates
power.
Its own power. Mm-hmm. And
unfortunately, though, that might not be enough. We'll come back to Dick Ault, the future Robinson Crusoe, following these words. Dick, I said, unfortunately, that might not be enough, this business of an emergency transmitter, assuming that it worked perfectly, and I, from flying and whatnot, I know that the best of electronic gear is often, it often lets you down just when you don't think it will. I remember my wife and I got into my small aircraft, and we flew from Los Angeles to Wilmington, Delaware, almost completely across the country. And without mishap, we had all kinds of electronic navigational equipment aboard. We ran into storms and everything. Nothing disrupted our transmission or reception. But coming back, as we flew back from Wilmington, Delaware, all the way across the country to Los Angeles, everything was fine until we got within 10 miles of the airport. And we called the tower for landing permission and instructions. And it was at that point that our receiver went out. And we had a backup system, which was also out. Now, here we were at a time when we never dreamed that we would have any kind of electronic failure. And what I had to do was something relatively dangerous. I had to make some passes at the tower to let them know that we were an aircraft in difficulty. And when I couldn't receive anything, I had to look for a green light. Now, I couldn't see the green light. I'd gone by a number of times, and I still couldn't see it. And I had to take the tremendous risk at that time of coming in and making a normal approach and landing, in spite of the fact that this is the rated as the second busiest airport, the one we were landing at, in the world, judged by the number of landings and takeoffs. But even that pales into insignificance when you think of you cranking away and not knowing whether or not your signal is being received. In the meantime, some member of your family might be suffering from appendicitis. And once again, I come back to these other people, and my advice to them would be, wouldn't it be smart for both of you, if you've never had it done, to just have your appendix taken out routinely now?
I had meant to bring this up before. We have both had our appendix taken out.
Oh, you have?
Yes.
Then what are you wasting my time for? Now,
I was trying to jump in.
Is there anything like that? I know that's, you know, probably the worst thing that could happen for the layman.
Mm.
Is there anything like that that you've researched that could happen?
Basically, no. This was the main problem, and oddly enough...
What about the baby?
Pardon?
What about the baby?
You mean in regard to appendicitis?
Yes.
Well, the chances, as I understand it, and we've been told this, of a young child getting appendicitis at that age are fairly rare.
Now, what about things like malaria, dengue fever, elephantiasis? What about those?
Well, now, this is what we had to look out for in choosing a particular island. It essentially had to be a malaria, elephantiasis-free area. Now, this first island that we were going to, Suvorov, was a completely free area, as so is Atta, the island that we are going to. This is because the island has never been inhabited, that these germs were never brought to these islands.
Are there any wild animals on the island?
The only wild animals that we know of are a few rats and iguana and birds,
mm-hmm.
and that is all.
No wild pigs?
Not that we know of.
Most of those islands abound in wild pigs. I don't know why, but
I know. I spoke with a captain in Suva, Fiji, who was on the island 2.5 years ago, and he had mentioned at that time that these were the only animals that he saw.
How big is your island?
It's approximately 2.5 miles long and 1.5 miles wide, Joe.
Well, this is literally an atoll.
Yes, although this particular island has 1,165 feet of elevation, and there are two extinct...
Boy, it must be one mountain.
Yes, it almost is.
Literally one mountain.
And there are two extinct volcanic craters on the island.
Does it have a lagoon?
Yes, about a half-shaped lagoon, you might say.
Mm-hmm.
So in the event of a hurricane or a typhoon or something like that, we have adequate protection.
You'll build your
cave.
Own shelter, is that right, Dick?
Yes, indeed.
Are you handy with tools?
Very much so. We spent, part of the reason for going to Hawaii was spending the month and a half that we did studying with the natives at the Polynesian Cultural Center on the island of Oahu in the town of Laie in Hawaii.
Mm-hmm.
We spent a month and a half. We lived with them. We worked with them. Everything. We went through and
Well, learned. You must know that the Polynesian is a relatively implacable fellow who was not given to panic, who is about as easy come, easy go as any... subculture I've ever met. I have spent a lot of time down in the South Pacific.
Mm-hmm.
Celebrated my 18th birthday in Pango Pango. Been all through the South and the South Central Pacific as well as other parts, and have been on many, many atolls. And these people are relatively free of fear. As a matter of fact, they're very childlike in their approach to almost everything. Crime is literally unknown among them, serious crime,
mm-hmm.
that is. And it's... I think not just difficult, it's impossible, really, for a civilized man to step out of his mold and be a Polynesian-type guy.
Well, I think it would be impossible had the preparation not been there. As I mentioned, we for 5 years have been reading and reading and reading everything about the South Pacific possible.
And then you're going to step ashore on that island and you're going to find something you never read about.
This perhaps could be.
Have you ever tasted iguana?
Yes, I tasted iguana in a New York restaurant.
Is that right?
Yes, yes.
Well, I've seen them. I've never tasted one, but to me it would be something like eating a baby dinosaur.
Well, this was extremely delicious. It was a delicacy, actually.
Probably iguana. Prepared by some French chef. Is your wife a good cook?
Yes, she is.
Mm-hmm. Now, what about the psychological ramifications here? I knew a man one time who encouraged his wife to go on a trip with him on their own boat. It was about a 35-foot sailboat to Hawaii. And they say that they'd gone through a number of storms along the way, as people will do, and as you will do on the island, of course. And they finally arrived at Hawaii. They say that she was the first one off the boat, and she walked up the pier and disappeared into the traffic or so forth around the marina, and he never saw her again. That's about 8 years ago. In other words, they didn't wear well. Now, what about the psychological impact? Are you and your wife going to spend a year out there only to find out that the proximity and the absolute parochial setup there is going to make you hate each other?
Naturally, we've given this a lot of thought. I think we will have one advantage that they didn't have. We'll have our child along. Now, this will be one small advantage. We have always enjoyed doing things together, and we honestly believe, of course we don't know for sure, but we honestly believe that we'll get along together because...
You think your love will survive?
Yes, oh, very much so. First of all, we both want this. We both are doing it for the very same reasons. We both have many things that we want to accomplish on the island, and we think that this will bring us closer together, perhaps, than any man and wife could ever hope to know each other.
I would think so, because I don't know what conversation you're going to have with your 3.5-year-old daughter, but it certainly won't suffice for the kind of conversations that you're going to have day in and day out, night in and night out. We'll be back to adventurer Dick Ault following these words. Speaking of the negative side again, have you considered what might happen in the event that your baby should come down with something like acute tonsillitis?
Yeah.
How would you take care of that?
Now, let me explain this, Joe. First of all, the medical books and notes that we have had prepared for us, not only by a doctor back in Ohio, but also by a doctor in Honolulu who has been doing work on this and still to this day is doing work, he has laid out for us all of the symptoms possible. And it's in almost like a directory file that if a certain symptom should come up, in other words, there's a point to where we can do so much, and then we've got to get help. Now, the island we're going to is 85 miles south of Nuku'alofa, the capital of Tonga. And we have been advised that we could get help out there within 6 to 8 hours, if necessary.
From a witch doctor, you mean?
No, from a physician in...
A real medic.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. This business of being given permission to be on this Tonga island, who gave you permission?
The King of Tonga himself. I spoke with the King's aide a number of times over the phone in Honolulu. This is where a lot of our money went to, was on the telephone calling throughout the South Pacific.
Yes.
And I originally talked with a gentleman down there from a travel service. And then I started talking with the King's aide himself, and he has given us verbal permission. I hope to be going down there now within about 3 weeks to receive official written permission. But they're very anxious for us to come down.
Why are they anxious?
Well, for this reason, they are aware of the publicity that has that we've had in the past in regard to this. The economy of Tonga is in a very bad state. And they have no way to turn but to tourism. So they believe that
this might be the island that, the Richard Ault stayed there, and maybe we want to camp out there, and we get permission, and we pay for this.
I have no idea what they have in mind, but essentially this is it.
Good public relations.
Yes, yes.
Is there a chance that you might fall in love with this way of life so much that you might never come back?
Well, I'm a South Pacific lover, although I've...
Why? Why are you?
I don't know.
Have you been there?
Well, I've been to Hawaii, and I flew down with the National Aeronautics and Space Administration. I spent a week on Canton Island. That's the only part of the South Pacific I've ever been in. I've been through all of the Caribbean.
What did you think of Canton?
I loved it. I spent 4 days by myself, about 6 miles down away from the encampment there.
And funny, anybody, I was going to say that anybody who loves Canton can't be all sane. That is one of the I would think, the lesser islands from the standpoint of appeal. However, there are some beautiful places down there. And if you can survive, if you're the kind of a man that can take up tools and climb trees and build himself a shelter and this kind of thing, it's conceivable that you might never come back.
We have thought of this.
Could a man live there without money forever, do you think?
Well, I think so.
Now, but as your daughter got older, you'd want to educate her.
Well, this, of course, is something that we'd have to naturally consider.
Would you try to do it yourself?
By myself?
Mm-hmm. You and your wife, I mean.
Oh, I see.
Try to educate the little girl?
Oh, yes. Well, of course, we will during the year. You mean in the event we would decide to stay? I really can't say at this point. This would have to be based, of course, on how happy she is with it and everything else.
What about the lack of companionship?
Well, for her, you mean, our daughter?
Yes, of course.
This is another thing that we're going to have to watch out and be very careful for. Basically, what we are seeking, all three of us going to this island, is happiness.
Peace.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm just thinking that 3.5-year-old girls, like other 3.5-year-old, 4-year-old girls to play with, that kind of thing.
And she does especially. But
have you considered taking another couple with you?
No, not in the least.
Not in the least.
No, we want to do this by ourselves.
Somebody with another little girl or a little boy about the same age?
Well, no, we haven't, because, as I say, we want to do this by ourselves for the simple reason that we want to be alone together.
I'm just sitting here wondering how many people are saying to themselves, I wish I could go. You realize, of course, Dick, that you're one in who knows how many million who dream about this kind of thing and never do it. Never put it into action. You're putting it into action.
Well, I think that's where it all started, Joe. I think we were part of that million that dreamt of it, and we decided, as I say, definitely a year ago, we decided definitely that this summer or this fall we were going to do it. And had it not been for the unusual situations that occurred with the Cook Island government, we'd be there right now.
You've read all of the military survival manuals you could get your hands on.
Oh, yes.
Mm-hmm. Will you take firearms?
I'm going to take one rifle, yes. We'll pack the rifle, the shortwave transmitter, and the emergency medical supplies away in hopes that we'll never have to use any of them during the year that we're down there.
What about matches?
Pardon?
Matches.
Yes, this is one thing we have decided to take, because just preparing your food in itself will be an 8-hour, 8-9-hour a day job. And we've decided that rubbing sticks together 3 times a day is going to get a little monotonous after a while. So
well,
we have decided
you might
to
try
take matches.
Rubbing coral together, because it works better than sticks.
Yes, I've heard of this too.
Dick, we wish you bon voyage, and may I request that when you come back, if you do come back, and I hope you will, that you'll come back here on this program and tell us about it?
I'd be glad to.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Dick Ault has been our guest. We wish him bon voyage. This is Joe Pyne, and I'll be back following station identification.